Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the show. This is episode 5 of the Paint Desk Ramblings, and this episode will be about community-driven, that term used by the Ninth Age. I will discuss a little bit how I interpret it and how others have interpreted it, and see where that gets me. The main topic will probably not be that long, but to compensate, there have been a ton of news. Partly because it was a while ago that I did an episode. The main reason for that is that I was to a tournament last weekend, VetCon in Jönköping. I might do an episode where I talk a bit about the games that I play there, but not this one. I will say though that I had a lot of fun, played 5 great games, and I took home a Best Painted award as well, which was nice. So I'm really happy with that tournament. The other reason that I haven't updated in a while is that I'm preparing to go on a trip, probably sometime this week I will leave, so there won't be any episodes for a while after that, probably something like 5 weeks or so, but we'll see, you never know. But as I said, there has been a ton of news, so we will get into that shortly. But first, the hobby spotlight. And I'm working on another of my little rats this evening. A plebeian with a blunderbuss that I will be using in skirmish campaigns. And he's got a magnet in his little rock that he's standing on, so I'm able to switch out his base if I want to, with the intention of maybe using him as a Yisail in my army to come for Vermin Swarm. The producer is of course Dragonclaw Miniatures, as is the rest of my Vermin Swarm army, but I have converted it with a blunderbuss from the Games Workshop old militia, Empire Militia kit, or Free Company, or whatever they were called. But there's lots of useful little bits in that kit, so I used one here. And it was a really good fit. So yeah, I'll show you a picture of how it looks when I started the episode, and you'll see another at the end of the episode. The sketching is already done of the miniature, so I'm just coloring it in. We'll see how that goes. So, on to the news. First, some miniature news. Lumbart Miniatures have had a successful Kickstarter for Undying Dynasties, with a Greek, undead Greek theme, which is really cool, I think. They have opened up for pre-orders now, a while ago, and their first casts are starting to appear, and it looks really good, I think. I might get some of their Sandstalker miniatures, which are basically just worms, that looks really nasty. Might get some of those as either Sandstalkers or Sand Scorpions for my own Undying Dynasties army somewhere down the line. Not sure though, because I will probably only play terracotta, and as I understand it, Sand Scorpions and Sand Stalkers are not that worthwhile in such an army because they lose their ambush rule. But anyway, they are really cool, so check them out if you want to. We also have a brand new company that have announced their support for the Ninth Age, Red Line Miniatures. So far they don't have that much to offer, it seems, but I think they have plans to make an entire range for Sylvan Elves, which is cool to see. They do have some Blade Dancers already. Models, which looks pretty sweet. They are a bit different from what you usually see on elf models, in that the elves are not that beautiful. Usually elves are like the epitome of perfection and all that, but these not really. And I think it's intentional, and I quite like it. So if it's your cup of tea, you should check them out. I'll share a picture up on the screen, as usual. So, I think that's about it for miniature news. And onto the project more. The perhaps most important news of these past weeks is that the Ninth Age has a brand new website, a portal site. That is the first thing you see when you type in the ninthage.com. You come to this portal where you can find a link to the forums, which are unchanged. So all of that is left intact, but the portal serves as an introduction to the hobby and such, which can be really valuable, I think. I personally don't really like this kind of website. I find them really annoying to browse, but I do understand that I'm not the target audience. So that's fine, but you will find a page for every faction in the game. Each 16 factions has its own page, and on that page you will find a short fluff description of what the army is, a short description of the play style and such, how they are used in games, which I think has been commented that there's quite a lot of errors in those texts, but I'm sure they will sort that out soon enough. I'm not that worried. There's also a link to the miniature library on the forums, so you can check out what miniatures you can use for the faction. A link to the forum page where you can discuss everything about the faction, and a link to the rulebook, the slim rulebook, and if there is one available, also to the full rulebook. So that's really cool. Perhaps best of all, though, is that in the bottom of the page for each faction you can find a gallery of, for most armies that is. They don't have every army so far, I'm sure they will add those later, but you will find a gallery of pictures of armies from people's collections that they have volunteered to the project. My own Vampire Covenant army can be found on that page, so I'm really proud of that. along with another army, not only my army. But I really like that addition to the website, and I hope to see more. I also hope to be able to add more of my armies to that page, as I'm expanding my own collection. So we'll see how that goes in the future. About the fluff pieces on the page, I think what caught me the most was for the Vermin Swarm. The fluff pieces, they are quite straightforward, seem to be written from a almost omniscient perspective, but it has been confirmed that it is not. It's someone in the world that has written these texts. We just don't know who. There's no attribution, no reference to who has written them, which I think is a shame, but we'll see. Maybe they can fix that later. But the fluff pieces give a pretty comprehensive view, the basic view of the army, what they are about, their goals and such. And my favorite, I'd say, is the Vermin Swarm one. I haven't read them all in that great detail yet, but in the Vermin Swarm I found a detail that I don't think has been mentioned before, and that is about the houses of the Vermin Swarm. So the, and I might butcher these names, the Rakashit, Fethis, and Sikara. So there's houses of, I'm sure there are more as well, but those houses are apparently based on the Avras of old, as is the case with much of the Vermin Swarm, but it was nice to have it in clear text, I think. So that's cool. That's cool. There is also a page for general fluff. I think the page is called World, where you will find the World Hymn, a transcript of it. It's nice to have that easily accessible, and it's also nice to have it in an official source, where you can see the order of the verses, because it wasn't super clear in the main rulebook in what order you should read the verses. So that's good. You could figure it out and become pretty much 100% sure, but it wasn't obvious at first, at least. So that's nice. There's also a link to the 9th wiki, the community wiki for the 9th age, which is nice to get that out there. I appreciate that. And yeah, I think that's about it for the website. As I said, I don't really like that kind of website, find it annoying to browser, but I think it will be very useful to new players coming that hear about 9th age. You want to look it up and understand what it's about, because the forum page was not really a good way to greet players. And I understand that I'm a bit strange not liking this kind of web pages, I think, at least. But whatever. I think it's good that they have it. So, moving on to the next news item, which is also a big piece of news. And that is the the new Ninth Scroll has dropped, issue 16, which is also always a great pleasure. to read and look through. So in this episode there is an article about the design process of the Infernal Dwarves, and I talked about a little bit about this in a previous episode, but they go a bit more detail here, I think. Talk about how they are working to design the book and all of that. There's some, excuse me, I need to check this bottle first. There's some nice pieces of information, I think. They say that there will be, in the new book, there will be more focus on the churches of the Infernal Dwarves. That is, and again, I will probably butcher the names, but there are churches to their four gods, Ashuruk, Shamut, Nesiblikesh, and Lugar. So those will be more prominent in the rules for the army. Don't really know how, but it sounds good. It's always good to get the background more visible through the rules, I think. So that's cool. The Tauruks of the army will have a very strong bull focus in the fluff in the rules, I think. They are saying that they will be more focused on on first turn damage and sharp charge bonuses and such, which seems fitting. I think they lost a bit of the some of those rules some time ago because they wanted to make the Infernal Dwarves focused on grinding. I think they still will be, but not necessarily every single unit has to be that. And I think people will appreciate it, so that's good. And then the main part of the article was about the Infernal Artillery. And basically what they are saying is that, seeing as the Infernal Dwarves are such an industrial faction, they have real industries and such, they can have a modular design of their artillery, which basically means that there will be several different guns that they can employ, so flamethrowers and cannons and mortars and Gatling guns and all of that. And then there will be several different chassis where they can mount it. So you pick a chassis and you pick a gun and you get a unit, an artillery piece. So the chassis can be a a train carriage, a weapon team, or yeah, several other things. I can't really recall what they were, but I think it sounds really, really cool. As an engineer myself, this modular thinking is of course appeals to me, so that's nice. Moving on, we also get another extract from the background companion in this new 9 in this new scroll. This time it's the spread for the Saurian Ancients, which is really cool to see because it's a faction that we had quite little information about before. Now we get some really cool pieces of information, I think. So the main narrator of this background compendium, I'm sorry, I just bumped a rat into the microphone. The main narrator, who we don't know who it is really, I think, is a bit uncertain about these stories of the Sauron Ancients being the world rulers back in the Dawn Age, and every other sentient race was basically slaves to them. He questions that a bit, which I think is cool that they bring in different perspectives on things. There's also another source, another narrator that mentions the another named for me to butcher, Manginiki, a tribe that lives in Viretia. Possibly human. I would guess that they are human, but it's not explicitly mentioned. But if they are, cool. I really like that they have humans all over the world. That's good. And in the story about this tribe, the narrator retells a tale that the chieftain of the tribe told him about how their ancestors were slaves to the Sauron Ancients, and that they have constantly lived in fear of them, basically. And the narrator is struck by the disturbing similarities between this story and the stories he was told as a child by his grandmother or aunt, I don't recall. A relative back in his hometown, Ulsberg, in the Empire of Sornstal. So they have similar stories even there, and I think that's a cool concept. There's also a text that gives some thoughts about the different species of the Saurian Ancients. It's a bit unclear, this one. It's written from the perspective of some sort of professor who has observed the Saurians for a while. And he writes about his conclusions from day to day. The first one, he mentions that another expedition found a specimen with four legs that they examined and couldn't really make sense of, I think. And he now believes that those specimens were the males of the species, and it wasn't very large, this specimen, so it seems to suggest that the males of the Sauron Ancients are these small, like normal lizards, while the females are the large bipedal one. But it's not clear exactly what species he's talking about, if it's the Skinx, the Quathel, or the Saurian warrior species. Which brings us to the next part, where he mentions that there is no apparent hierarchy between the species. And he mentions that the Skinx are not naturally beneath the Gila, he calls them, which I think might be the species of the Saurian warriors. But again, it's not explicitly mentioned. he also notes the Kaiman. One day, one of those appears, seem to the city or whatever it is he's observing, and they don't seem to be normal parts of the society, but they are welcomed as guests and are allowed to stay and mingle, basically. And he observes that they have a sort of childlike behavior. Sit on the beach, on the river banks, and play with sand, basically. So that's a bit neat. overall, the spread is focused a lot on the strangeness and mystics of the Sour Nations, which is good, because they really are the strangest of the races, of the factions. And I should also mention that this has been observed and commented on the forums, but this is a mention, there's a text that tells of different encounters with the Sour Nations. And this one is really, really focused, as I said, on the strangeness. And the text, in the text, they observe and lists encounters with the Saurians where they have behaved strangely. So there's different places all around the world where Saurians have appeared and made something and done something, and people just don't understand it. Sometimes they attack, sometimes they leave fruit, and sometimes they build strange things in the sand and whatever. And one of those mentions is from Monopatea, which is mentioned one other time in the background, in the main rulebook, where it is said to be the only remaining piece of the ancient Avras society. So it's a small city, I think, region or something, where that was never overrun by the vermin. So it maintains this Avrasi culture. So they are basically Romans, and they haven't been mentioned since then. And some people have been bothered by it, but now they are mentioned again, and it doesn't say anything about Monopatea itself. It just says that one time a bunch of during a famine, a bunch of Saurians showed up and left some food. So that's nice, I guess, but it doesn't tell us anything about what it is that place is about. But whatever. Overall, I think it's a good spread, this one. Maybe one of the best, but I haven't really thought through them in such terms. Maybe I should. Moving on. In the scroll, you will also find the results of the Golden Sword 2 competition, which was a painting competition on the forums for painting war machines. And you will find my entry there as well. I actually managed to win this competition through some sheer luck. It looked like I was gonna be second, but then the person at the top got disqualified for having posted the pictures of his miniatures elsewhere before the competition, and that was not allowed by the rules. So I got a cheeky little win, but I won't complain, because I got a gift card from war colors, and I'm right now actually using one of their paints on this little rat here, so I'm happy with that. He has painted his belt using their transparent ochre. So that's nice. And I now use transparent violet on his sword or dagger hilts. There's also an article in the Scroll about the new Citadel contrast paints. Looks pretty good, both the paints and the article. I haven't tried them myself, and I don't really know when I will get the chance to do that. But I think I will. It would be foolish not to. My general thought is that it's really cool to see Games Workshop experimenting with new paints, and I'm sure that these can be really useful for painters of all skill levels. So I will grab some someday. My only problem with them is that they come in the GV Games Workshop paint pot, and those are utter crap. There's no two ways about it. Difficult to open, difficult to maintain open, and dry out fast. So I don't like those paint pots at all. I've seen that you can transfer the paints to a drop bottle, but that just seems like a lot of bother. But I will get some of those paints one day and try them out. There's also an article about how to play smaller games of Ninth Age. I think they use 3,000 points as an example, as a way to get people into the hobby. They basically say that it's fine, the game works at that those levels too. And I can only agree with that. For a few months ago, I played quite a few smaller size games and had a really lot of fun with that, so I can recommend it. There's more official background also in the Scroll from another session of Ask the Sage, Herr Selig. So it's questions from the community that are answered by an in-world source. So basically the community takes the part of a common person in, I think they are in Avras, and he asks questions to this wise sage, and he gives replies and answers to them. So in this session, he asks what it is that, or we ask what it is that the Knights of Equitaine seek, or the Grail, what the Grail is that they seek. And he gives a very long answer to that. I haven't had the time to fully read this yet, but I did notice that in this reply Selig mentions a name, Kleppa, which is the name of the official Ninth Age mascot. So he is now an officially part of the background, I guess, which is cool. He's also asked about the Warriors of the Dark Gods, a long question about priests and how people become warriors and why there are mostly just warriors worshipping them and not priests and other things. Also a question, do female dwarves have beards? And the short answer is no. Selig has not observed any female dwarves with beards. And also, do male elves have beards? And again, the answer is no. Selig has not observed any such thing. But remember that these are in-world sources, yes, because Mr. Selig has not observed any, or Herr Selig, there might still be. Might still be female dwarves with beards and male elves with beards. Maybe even female elves with beards, who knows. So if you want to do a miniature with that, go ahead. No one is gonna stop you. He's also asked when the Sunnah cycle is put together. And the Sunnah cycle is basically the Bible. We have a few extracts from it in the sources available to us, mainly in the main rule book. And it the different texts in it talk a lot about Sunnah and her conquest of Avras and a lot of things about on that topic. Yeah. And apparently, much like the Bible, it has been translated and put together in different versions and such again and again and again. So not really a clear answer on that, which is a shame, but whatever. He's also asked what the highest position within the Church of Sunnah is. These two questions here were submitted by me, actually. So the highest position within the Church of Sunnah and who holds it. And the highest position is that of the Supreme Prelate, who has her court or palace or whatever in Riva, Arcalia. We sort of knew this already from a short little extract in the another scroll about the Empire of Sornstahl, but it's nice to have it cleared up. Unfortunately, we didn't get any name on the Supreme Prelate. I would have liked that, but maybe some other time. He's also, last question is where the world's largest library is, and I haven't really looked at the answer for that, but I think it's a cool question, so I will look into that later. More in the scroll, there's a tutorial on how to make blood using green stuff, so splashes and of blood and such. Seems pretty cool, might use that someday. There's a quick starter showcase where they show off the winners of all. There was competitions on the forums about quick starter armies, where anyone could enter and vote. So the winners of each of those competitions are shown here. So 16 awesome armies for the quick starter. My own Vampire Covenant army is part of this. There's a miniature review for Scribor miniatures, and a pretty cool tutorial about how to magnetize bases using washers. So if you have a movement tray that is magnetic, you can simply add washers to the underside of the bases, and voila. Instead of what I'm doing, to have a steel movement tray and magnets in the bases. So it's a different approach. I don't think I will use it, because now I've gone down this this path of magnets in the bases. But we'll see. You never know. So that's it for the news. So 40 minutes in. I said it was gonna be a lot. So time for the main topic, which is community driven. Yeah, this is a term that the Ninth Age has used to describe itself, and I think that has been a bit of a mistake, actually. When people read community driven, I think they reason, some people do, not everyone. Some people reason that oh, cool, community driven. Then they reason that hey, I'm part of the community. That means I'm the driver of this project. I decide what it does. And then they post on the forums with their ideas, which can be good ideas, bad ideas, presented in a bad way or a good way, whatever. And then down the line, they notice that their ideas are not implemented, and they get upset because, hey, it was community driven and they didn't use my ideas. And I think that's a shame, because people get excited about it and they make suggestions, and then they get unhappy about it later. And it's a communication error, so it's both parties are at fault. I think the Ninth Age could have done a better job at explaining what they are. Because, well, they are community driven in some regards, I will get to that. But people seem to get the wrong idea sometimes. And I will say that this is mostly a problem of the past. I don't see this as much anymore. So the reason this is so unreasonable, I think, to assume that just because you are technically part of the community, therefore the game should go in the direction that specifically you like, is, well, it's quite obvious, because if everyone thinks that, and there are thousands of Ninth Age players, and they all make suggestions on the forums, they can't all be implemented. That's simply impossible. Even if you make suggestions that are objectively good, if there is such a thing, and there isn't, they maybe can't be implemented at this time, or for whatever reason. And people are always of different opinion. So even if you think that your idea is really, really good, it won't mean that it that others will like it and that it can be implemented. It's not even a democracy, even if you get a lot of people to agree on your idea. It's the the ones who actually made the game that decide, and it is their game when you come down to it. So if they don't like it, they don't like it, and that's their decision to make. But they do reach out sometime through various surveys and other things where they want feedback and inputs. And in those cases, absolutely go ahead and give your ideas and see what happens. And I know that they have used suggestions made on the forums and implemented those in the rules. But the sheer quantity of suggestions mean that, for the most part, they are not implemented. But I think all of them are considered, at least. But let's move on to what community-driven actually means, at least in my opinion. And it's quite simple, if you ask me. Community-driven means that the game is made by people who are part of the community, not by the community as a whole, but by people who are part of the community. And if you look at the founders who created this game, they were for the most part ETC players who loved playing miniature war games, and they wanted to make a game to continue to do that. And a lot of people liked it and got on board. And that is basically the basic premise of it. It's people who think that this is something good. I have an idea here, I want to make it work, and and I want to use it myself. And they do something of it and then make it available to everyone else so that they can use it if they also like it. That's basically all there is to the Ninth Age. Some people thought, let's make a game that we like, and they then made it public to to everyone else to use if they also liked it. On some occasion they invited people to give their opinion and help them design the game. But it was never under the premise that someone else was going to decide what the game was about and such things. So yeah, I think that's pretty much all I have to say. A little rant, both about how people have come to view this and how the Ninth Age has presented it, because as I said, it's a communication error, and that is never just one party's fault. So I guess that will wrap this up. As I said, the main topic would be pretty short, but there was a lot of news to compensate. I'm pretty much finished coloring my own little rat here. There's still metal to do, but my plan is to use an undercoat, a clear coat, and a matte varnish on top of that to protect the miniature, and then do the metal, so that I still get the shininess of the metal paints. So that will happen later. But other than that, I managed to finish this little dude. And this was intended to be a speed painting method, but now I painted one miniature in 50 minutes, which I suppose is pretty good time for me, but I still need to work on this method to make it really fast. And to be fair, this is one of the more complex miniatures in the range because it is so converted. I think the mainstay troops will be a bit faster, hopefully. But that will do it for now, and probably, likely, for a good while. I might do an episode about the tournament before I leave, but I'm not sure about that. So, I'll see you next time. Cheers.